بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمد ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد. Like how in the worldly terms we have people who are thieves, who want to rob, who want to steal. They will be found in places where there is wealth. Why? Because that's where there is an opportunity. Likewise, dunya, nafs, shaitan, all these elements will go to places and make effort more where there is iman. When iman is stronger, more effort will be made. When amal will be stronger, more effort will be made. That's why the people of iman need to be more particular and more vigilant and more aware of this deception. Even in the time of Nabi alayhi salam, the munafiqeen, Surah Baqarah, ayat number 9, beginning initial verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is identifying again, Baqarah, cow, deception. Part of the deception is people around you, part of the deception is you in the deception and you have no awareness of that deception. يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. They think, they have this perception, they con in everybody including Allah. وَمَا يَخْدَعُونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَمَا يَشْعُرُونَ. They actually only deceiving themselves and they don't even know they are deceiving themselves. So the munafiqeen portrayed, they had an outward form thinking that we are conning the believers, we are conning Allah, we've got an external plan in place. But the problem is what? You are going to harm yourself in dunya and akhirat. Fi qulubihim marad. Allah is highlighting this so that the people of iman as well take a lesson, that the problem that you cannot see Allah, your focus is not akhirat, your actions, your daily amal is not conforming to the life of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is because their hearts are sick. فَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا. And because of the sickness increases. Like how a person is ill and he doesn't know he is ill and he considers himself to be healthy. So if he doesn't do the necessary tests and there are some symptoms and signs which he ignores, then that cancer can reach a level where it could terminate his life, or it is treated to a certain extent where it's blocked. So the worldly sickness is light compared to the spiritual sickness. وَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا. Their sickness increases and increases until it reaches a climax. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْذِبُونَ. And for them will be a severe torment and punishment. So it is deception. A person in himself personally might not even have that awareness, that shu'ur, that I am in the con. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like a person travelling in a supercar at a high speed and he sees the robot in front of him that is green, but he's seen it from a distance, he accelerates because he has this perception that it's going to turn yellow anytime and I need to cross it. If I get to it when it is red, then there is destruction possibly ahead. So he accelerates. But as he accelerates, it turns yellow and he's in a predicament now. So he decides, I'd rather press brakes. So how at high speed he brakes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, you are going in the wrong direction. أَلْهَاكُمُ التَّكَاثُرُ حَتَّى زُرْتُمُ الْمَقَابِرُ. That this ambition, this focus of yours of accumulating wealth, stockpiling assets, hoarding, will make you negligent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This mutual rivalry that you have to strive for dunya will make you forget Allah and His Rasul. Hatta zurtumul maqabir. This red robot will stop. The police will come and arrest you. The angel of death will come. When you die, you will see the reality. يَقُولُ ibn Adam. Nabi alayhi salam explains, person says, Mali, Mali, this is my wealth, this is my house, this is my cars, this is my assets. وَهَلْ لَكَ مِن مَالِكَ إِلَّا مَا أَكَلْتَ. That the only wealth that you really have is what you've ate. فَأَفْنَيْتَ. And now it's gone. أَوْ لَبِسْتَ فَأَبَلَيْتَ. You've wore that clothing and it's got old. أَوْ تَسَدَّقْتَ. Or you've given it for Allah, in the path of Allah. فَأَبَقَيْتَ. Now you have procured it, you have secured it. So the point being made by Nabi alayhi salam is that all these worldly commodities, even though you are using it and you are benefiting from it, yet it may not give you any benefit unless it is utilized in the avenues which Allah and His Rasul have stipulated. A Jamaat went to one person, made his tashkil for 4 months. He said, I may be ready, maybe not, what's the problem? He said, I'm concerned my wife won't allow me to go. So the person in the Jamaat said, no problem. Let's simulate a scenario and tell your wife hypothetically that I've got an opportunity now. Ask her, I've got an opportunity now to travel overseas. I need to stay for 3 years. I need to leave you, leave the kids. But this is the salary. See what she says. So we went home, first he told her, you know what, I want to go in Jamaat, mashallah, there's a Jamaat here, I need to go 4 months. She said, 4 months? There's something wrong with you, you've got a job, you've got a responsibility, you have to look after people, etc. Then a little bit later he said, you know what, I've got some good news, there's a job opportunity overseas, I need to go for 3 years, this is the salary, these are the perks, but I need to leave by this week here and give them an answer. She said, let's start packing your bags. So he said, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, pack my bags, I'm going out in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we need to realize that every asset that we have, we need to make it valuable. Otherwise, when a person dies, all his wealth will be distributed. That same spouse, in that same bed that you slept with them, they will marry somebody else and be sleeping in the same bed, in the same house, using the same cars. So there's no allegiance in dunya, there's no loyalty or faithfulness, no commitment. How much a person thinks so he is committed or people around him are committed, everything will come to an end except what we've committed to Allah and His Rasul. One person went to the dentist and he asked him a question, I need 2 wisdom teeth extracted. So the dentist said, it'll cost you $80. He said, that's too expensive, I cannot afford it. He said, can you make it cheaper? Find a way. He said, well, if you want and you're out for it, I can remove the anesthetic. He said, okay, fine. Then it'll cost you $60. He said, what else? Can you make it less? He said, yes, I can remove these. And I will just pull out the teeth with the pliers. He said, then how much? He said, $60. He said, it's too much still. Can you do it any cheaper? He said, I cannot do it any cheaper, but if you're really strained, then I'll get one of my students. He will use it as an experience on his resume. So for $10, he'll do it. He said, perfect. Book my wife for next week Monday. Book my wife for next week Monday. So allegiance. If we have to turn to anybody and rely on anybody, only Allah we can rely on. Our attention, our heart, our focus should turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, fa'afnaita, everything will come to an end. No matter what solution, what problem, what plan B's and C's we have, the only plan we should have is Allah and His Rasul. Otherwise, everything else is going to fail. We hear Quran and we hear Hadith, but a person, if he's not prepared, then it's going to catch up with him. They say there were 3 people, a death sentence was put, and they were supposed to be placed in front of a firing squad. So the first, while they were discussing, before they were brought in front of the firing squad, they said, let's develop a plan to escape. So developed a plan, and they said, we'll implement it. So the first person went, the soldiers got ready, they loaded their guns, cocked it. And then as they were busy, ready, they were going to aim, he screamed out in a loud voice, avalanche, avalanche, pointed to the mountains. As he turned around to look, he ran away. By the time they turned back, he was gone. Second prisoner, same. Soldiers got ready and he screamed, "Flood, flood." As they turned to look, he also escaped. So the third prisoner said, "This is a brilliant plan." He was brought in front of the firing squad and the rifles were aimed at him and they were ready to fire. And then he screamed in a loud voice and he pointed in opposite direction, "Fire, fire, fire, fire." And that's when he got shot. So to know what to do at the right time, now's the opportunity in this world. While we have it, let us use it. Ad-dunya darun liman la dar lahu. That person makes this world a house for one who's not own or possessing a house in akhirat. So either we've decided this dunya is my house, now I'll do everything, exhaust every avenue to decorate this house. Then a person, when death comes, he will not look forward to it. Why? Because this is his house. So his soul resists. He does not look forward to death. Whereas a person who prepared the house in akhirat is looking forward, like a foreigner who's staying in a foreign country sends funds to his home country and all the money he builds a house, makes a palace. He's waiting for when the opportunity comes to go back home. A person of iman is also looking for that opportunity. Inna dar al-akhirah lahiya al-hayawan. The actual life of akhirah, that's life, that's loving, that's enjoyment, that's pleasure, that's ecstasy. Wa malun liman la mal lahu. And this dunya is wealth for a person who does not have any wealth. The person has wealth, actual wealth is the wealth of akhirah. Whereas we find people are looking for opportunities, whether it's in the stock markets, whether it's in businesses, whether it's in occupation, whether it's in professions. We're looking for wealth of dunya, but who's there to look for the wealth of akhirah? وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ الْغُرُورِ. It's only deception upon deception upon deception. وَلَهَا يَجْمَعْ مَنْ لَا أَقْلَ لَهُ. That person gathers this wealth, where there's no comprehension, no intelligence, he's got no judgment, no faculty. Because the people of iman got that vision and they realized the objective. وَتَزَوَّدُوا فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى. The best provision is taqwa. If you have to gather a treasure, it's the treasures of taqwa. The two youngsters were arrested for mugging an old lady. Police officer took them to the police station and he said that you've got one call, so make your phone call and then I'll have to put you in the cell. So they said fine, they made the one phone call, gentleman came in, police officer met him. He said, I suppose you the lawyer, I suppose you the lawyer. So the person told the sergeant, no, I'm actually the pizza delivery man, I'm here to deliver the pizza. So these youngsters were so caught in dunya that at that time of need, what they should have been doing, they're not doing that. Now's the time, not tomorrow, not next week, not whenever. We don't know how many people around us, there are signs. People are departing every day, Elan. Every day we are hearing the Elans. Every moment. And yet is our heart so hard that we're not taking lesson? وَعَلَيْهَا يُعَادِي مَنْ لَا عِلْمْ عِنْدَهُ. And that person becomes habitual and accustomed to dunya, who does not have any knowledge of akhirat. So, we supposed to be accustomed to salat, tilawat, adhkar, amal, learning deen, teaching deen, spreading deen. But a person lose focus. وَعَلَيْهَا يَحْسُدْ مَنْ لَا فِقَ لَهُ. And that person has jealousy and malice, who does not have the understanding of deen, does not have the comprehension, the judgment, the intelligence to understand that this is an opportunity. Looking at other people's wealth and having jealousy and malice does not benefit one. But whose heart is hard, he looks and he thrives. وَلَهَا يَسْعَى مَنْ لَا يَقِينَ لَهُ. And that person who has no yaqeen in akhirat, his morning, his evening, He's striving all the time to see how he can acquire this dunya. But when a person makes effort in the wrong direction, خَسِرَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ, he loses his dunya, he loses his akhirah. Like one lawyer told his client, who was found guilty of murder, and he was supposed, a punishment was going to be passed, the decree. So he said, I have good news and bad news. So tell me the bad news first. He said, you're going to get the electric chair. You're going to get the electric chair. So he says, then what good news is there? The lawyer said, I know the person who adjusts the voltage. I know the person who adjusts the voltage. He can lower it. Even if he does lower it, you're still gonna die. So what's the benefit of the good news? So dunya comes with good news all the time, so that we procrastinate this death and that which is inevitable. It's going to happen. Man asbaha wa dunya akbar hammihi. Whoever wakes up in the morning and their concern and their fikr and their worry is dunya, amassing wealth, gathering wealth, and not the obedience of Allah and sacrificing for Allah. Alzam Allah qalbahu arba khisal. Allah puts four azabs on this person. Number one, hamman la yanqati'u minhu abada. He will have so much grief, so much worry, so much stress, so much anxiety. His anxiety will never end. Whenever you meet him, worry, concern, problems. That's the first azab. They say one day there was a shepherd and a supermodel walked past. He was amazed and baffled by her beauty. So he was staring at her. So she said, you like what you're looking at? He said, yeah, I love it. And if I had opportunity, I would have married you. She said, done deal. You are shocked, surprised, baffled. Let's go. If that's the deal, let's go now. Went to the Qadi. Where's the bride? Brought the bride. He looked at the bride. Supermodel. Subhanallah. He was also perplexed. How can you be marrying her? She's not eligible for you. She needs to marry me. So he went to the bigger Qadi. This time of the day, you're troubling me. You know, something urgent. What? I need to get married. Subhanallah. Come. Where's the bride? Seen her? MashaAllah, she's not eligible for you, she's a supermodel. She has to marry me. Nobody else in the country, so I have to phone the minister that hour. Why are you traveling me so late? No, I need to get married. Okay, no problem, come, seen the bride. Wow, supermodel, she's not eligible for you, she has to marry me. Who's left? The king, the president of the country. Go to the king. This time of the hour, you're troubling me. No, I need to get married. Okay, no problem, come. Came, seen the bride, she's not eligible for you, she needs to marry me. So the bride says, okay, if all you want to marry me, then you can marry me, but let's find a solution. I'm going to run and whoever catches me, I'll marry them. So the shepherd started running, the judge, the big judge, the minister, the king, the president, the prime minister. If we look out of our windows today, on the highways, on the airways, on the railways, we'll see the kings, the ministers, the paupers, the street sweepers, all of them are running. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the haqiqat of this dunya. Surah Tabarak to read every night. In the qabr it'll come, fatu'ta rijlahu, it'll come to his feet. If even azab it'll come, it'll block. It'll say, no way, you cannot pass. Min qibal sadrihi. And it'll come by his chest, adab, you cannot touch him. Min qibali ra'si, it'll come to the head, adab, you cannot touch him. Surat al-mulki fahiyya al-mania, it prevents adab. Tamna'u adab al-qabri. Once sahaba passed by a place, they put up a tent, they pitched a tent, they could hear Surat Tabarak. And they told Nabi alayhi salam, Darabtu khiba'i ala qabrin wa ana la'ah. سيب أنه قبر فإذا قبر إنسان يقرأ سورة الملك. I heard somebody reading the entire surah Mulk. Nabi alayhi salam said, he al-mania, He'll munjia, it'll prevent and protect you from the azab of qabr. May Allah give us tawfiq of making amal. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.